Could I just check that everybody can see me who needs to? Thank you. Firstly, I would like to send apologies from Dr. Terry Riley, who's unable to attend this evening, and I've substituted his place. So my name is Paul Redfern, and I accept your apology, Sean, for my name being spelled wrong on the agenda. Thank you. But I'd also like to thank you both for having me here this evening. So I'm here from the British Deaf Association, and I would first of all like just to tell you a very short story about my personal experience. I was called upon to give a presentation at a university, and I began signing but using my voice at the same time. Now I had an interpreter present, but the interpreter was not working at the very beginning of my presentation, and I could tell that the audience were struggling to understand me because they were not tuned in to my deaf voice. After a short while, I reverted to working via the interpreter who voiced over on my behalf, and you could feel the relief in the audience that was palpable. And it really hit me at that moment that the interpreter was not there just for me. The interpreter was there for myself and for the rest of the audience, so that we could all understand each other. Now, the Access to Work cap will not only affect deaf people, it will affect the people that we need to communicate with. David Buxton this morning, who is Chief Exec of Action on Disability, was on the Victoria Derbyshire programme. And he stated that in the UK, the situation that deaf people need to face is very comparable with that MPs need to face when they go to Europe to hold their discussions. Now imagine if their interpreting budget was cut in half. Imagine how well they would be able to continue to do their job. Now, as has been already mentioned, those who are affected by this new cap, 90% of them will be members of the deaf community, and 80% of those will be sign language users, those who use BSL as our first or preferred language. The BDA has noted a number of incidents where deaf people have actually lost their professional registrations because they were unable to claim for enough interpreting hours and they could no longer continue their continuous professional development that would allow them to maintain these registrations. I apologize. There has been surveys under the Deaf Access to Work website, which many of you will be familiar with, that state 46% of claimants will not apply for a work promotion as a direct result of this cap. Employers themselves have grave concerns about their deaf members of staff who will experience this cap, and the employers will therefore be expected to subsidise the shortfall. And therefore, this is potentially rendering many deaf people unemployable. Imagine the number of quite small businesses who simply will be unable to cover the shortfall left by this cap. Deaf people will literally have to leave work and be replaced by hearing people. I'm sure many of you have heard the same story, where people apply for a job, an employer will simply say, no, we can't employ you as a deaf person because we're aware of the difficulties that that will bring along with it. So employers will become more and more reluctant to employ deaf members of staff because they will be seen as expensive. We recently conducted a survey on 200 deaf young people who told stories of their rejections from both employed work and work experience, not because they're not bright enough, but because they're deaf. And some of these young deaf people are leaving education with no hope for their future, with only a hope of remaining in menial jobs. This evidence has been presented to the government and was also recently presented to the UN in Geneva. The UN CRPD committee stated their own concerns that there is not enough availability of highly qualified sign language interpreters to supply the demand generated within the deaf working community, deaf workforce. Those interpreters have been affording deaf people equality and equity via access to work for many years, and that support is now being cut. The British Deaf Association sees this as a huge regressive step, and it is untenable. Access to work is clearly a vital component of deaf people remaining in the workplace. But don't forget, this is a two-way street. It is not only us who benefit, it is everybody who benefits because of the contribution that we are therefore able to make. We could not achieve what we are able to achieve without access to work. And I'd just like to conclude by thanking you all for your attention this evening. Thank you.
Thanks very much. Thank you, Paul. Well, on to the next speaker. Next speaker being, why a framework agreement might mitigate the impacts of the cap. Nick Evans, numbers of the National Union of British Sign Language Interpreters. Nicky.